Right here we've got the RTX 3080 TUF Gaming OC from ASUS, and ultimately I am going to be recommending this card right here over the Founders Edition for three reasons. And we'll get into the first of those right now, where we've got the temperatures and cooling on this card. Coming in roughly 15 degrees cooler out of the box, this is one of the biggest reasons for getting one of these cards. You're going to run virtually the same noise. I did notice that the Founders was ever so slightly quieter, but at 15 degrees C, that is a big cost for that little difference in noise. And this ties in with the second reason, and this is our lower temperatures, which now allows us to have sustainable overclocks. And with the Founders Edition, I didn't recommend overclocking that because I wasn't comfortable with the temperatures when it was overclocked. And I feel like with the Founders Edition, they've put all this extra metal on the cooler that isn't actually functional. It's more for aesthetic purposes versus the TUF Gaming, which has the thin frame on the front near the fans and then a thin backplate, which does add to the aesthetics. So most of the weight on this card is in the actual cooling design itself. So it's a fantastic implementation for a TUF Gaming card, to the point where it feels more reminiscent of a Strix design than a TUF Gaming card ever was. Though when I started overclocking this thing, grabbing that slider, smashing the dial up on the memory then went to levels I've never seen before, and that is over 10 gigahertz, which essentially equals 20 gigabits per second effective. And then for the core clocks, we got over 130 megahertz out of the core, bringing this to a maximum of 2.1 gigahertz on all those CUDA cores on this GPU. And this led to big gains in the gaming numbers. And I'll show you guys the 4K numbers here today. If you wanna see 1080p and 1440p numbers, I'll refer you to my Founders review, which I'll put the link up for here. But basically the Founders and the ASUS TUF Gaming OC card out of the box, these pretty much performed identical. They were both boosting up to around 1980 megahertz. The quiet mode was boosting up to very similar levels. And when I tested the quiet mode in Shadow of the Tomb Raider, it spat out the exact same FPS as the other two cards did. Well, at least the TUF Gaming in performance mode. So for the rest of the benchmarks, I then left it in performance mode. And then moving over to Horizon Zero Dawn, this was giving us over 10% increase in FPS. And then over to MechWarrior 5, we saw a similar trend to that of Shadow of the Tomb Raider, giving us a boost, but not a huge boost. And then Doom Eternal was giving us 176 average FPS versus 166. And then after that, we had the Outer Worlds, which gave us the biggest increase out of the overclocking numbers in the benchmarks here today, going from under 100 FPS to now 111 average FPS. And then the Division 2 gave us 74 versus 78 average FPS. And then lastly, Modern Warfare giving us a similar boost as we saw with the Division 2. So the overclocking numbers, in my opinion, make it really worth it. If you're going to be getting the latest and greatest graphics card, and you're going to be running this at 4K, 120 FPS, which if we saw in all those games, this was max settings. You can't max the dial anymore, and you're getting pretty much close to 120 FPS in a lot of these titles. And you can drop it down to high in some of the other ones that aren't getting 120 FPS. This card is capable of doing that, and that's the biggest benefit of it, coupled with the HDMI 2.1. However, one negative of overclocking, of course, is the increased power consumption, and we'll pull up those numbers right here for you guys. We can see roughly a 40 watt increase over the out-of-the-box settings, but the total system power consumption, getting roughly 10% extra performance in gains, is worth that 10% extra wattage from the wall, in my opinion. And the Founders was using a little bit more than the TUF Gaming OC was because it was running a little bit hotter. And so basically the hotter the chips get, the less efficient they get too. So with reason two out of the way, we're now moving over to reason three, and that is the input output. With the Founders card, you get three display ports and one HDMI 2.1. With the TUF Gaming OC, you get three display ports and two HDMI 2.1s. However, it's also got a stainless steel input-output shield. And I really like this because, especially if you live near the beach, over time, your cards can succumb to rust, especially those input-output ports, where I've had to in the past put a bit of multi-purpose spray and give those ports a bit of tech yes loving, where I'm inserting a HDMI cable like 20 or 30 times to get the port working again. This won't do it because it won't rust out. And with all those raw numbers out of the way, it's time for a conclusion where I'll talk also about the aesthetics and I'll throw the dimensions of this card right up here on the screen for you guys. But you've got a little bit of RGB with the TUF Gaming logo towards the edge of the card. Another benefit, in my opinion, is it uses 2 8-pin connectors versus the 12-pin Nvidia's new school connector, which I personally prefer the old school because I don't have to run out and grab a new power supply. But speaking of power supplies, this is out of the box one of the most power hungriest cards I've seen come through here at the studio. So what that means is you will really want a good power supply, not just for the rating, but also the thickness of the wires and making sure you're getting a power supply that has the right gauge to deliver the right amount of power to these cards. Because if you don't have the right amount of power, then your card can do some janky stuff. It can cut out, it can give you lower FPS, the list goes on. But this card right here, it works a treat. And if you're a gamer and you can get your hands on one of these, you're gonna be having happy days. But speaking of those happy days, right now, the supply is extremely limited. I made a video on pricing and supply, and it looks like you're gonna be getting one of these things towards the end of October at the earliest, because they're pretty much sold out everywhere. But that being said, when it does come back into stock, I can recommend this thing at $750 USD, and in Australia, I believe the pricing should be around $1,250 Aussie dollars. That's at least what I'm told it should be at, even though the initial launch prices were higher. However, you're probably wondering, what about the ray tracing and DLSS numbers? I'll just pull up the previous numbers for you guys, where they pretty much came in identical with the founder's card. But one thing I will tell you is that when I tried overclocking and then running ray tracing, the games crashed out pretty quickly. I couldn't get any solid ray tracing overclocked numbers for you, if that means anything. So if you want to turn on ray tracing, you probably just have to leave the settings as they are out of the box and turn on DLSS 2.0, which DLSS 2.0 does do a good job in the games that I've tested it in. Anyhow, in closing out, I'm gonna give props to ASUS for the design and implementation of this card. It's a fantastic job that they've done with the card itself, despite all the other things going on at the moment with the RTX 3000 launch. They've also used, on top of the axle fans, dual ball bearings, as well as throwing in a 3-year warranty on these cards, which if you're gonna be overclocking and you're gonna be playing this for long amounts of time, I would want a card that has a decent warranty. Anyhow, with that aside, do let us know in the comments section below what you think of this card right here. Love reading your thoughts and opinions as always. And if you stayed this far, then you can help us out by tossing us a like, hitting that sub button, ringing that bell, and I will catch you guys in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.